Imagine starting your career as a young lawyer, vowing to uphold the rule of law, only to find yourself years later raging against the weaponization of it with you as the prime target. Imagine being a human rights defender, championing all those who face injustice, only to join them behind bars. Imagine spending almost 7 years in detention, away from family and friends, not being with them in their joys, not being with them in sadness, not being with them at all when they leave, never seeing them again, only for your accusers to all of a sudden sing a different tune, leading to you gaining your temporary liberty. Now stop imagining, because you don't have to, because all you need to do is to know the story of our next guest. And Leila de Lima will tell you. It's about triumph and turmoil and victory within reach. But how does she intend to begin again? Let's ask her. Leila de Lima, one of the remarkable women we honor this month, joins us here today. Senator, good afternoon to you. Thanks for joining us today.
Good afternoon,
welcome to the program.
Quite a delight to be invited in your program, and great to see you again.
Great to see you again. How have you been doing? How has your temporary liberty been?
Well, it's been both exciting and tiring because I'm everywhere. I have all sorts of invitations, speaking engagements, and all other events and activities with relatives, with friends, with former allies, and of course, media interviews. So I've been very busy. I haven't had any real quality private time since my release last November.
How would you describe what you saw after you stepped out, or what you're experiencing now? Is it more of the same? Is it a little bit different, but really just the same in terms of the environment?
Both the same and different, although of course I had to adjust from a world of solitude in my compound there at the PNP Custodial Center, and to a world of diverse activities, of energy, of active life. And it's the politics, of course, is still the same, noisy as ever, turbulent as ever, getting more exciting by the day with all of these issues we're having now. So it's just really the same. But I had to do a lot of adjustments because I wasn't used to it anymore. I was just, you know, it was a solitary life, fairly quiet life, and not much activity inside my detention quarters.
Tell us about that time when you were being escorted out of the Senate. To me, it was vivid because we were covering it then. But as you were being escorted out of the Senate, did it occur to you, or when did it occur to you, that life as you knew it then was ending?
Well, it was not really a feeling of the end of my life, but it was very uncertain to me. I didn't know how long would I be incarcerated. In fact, when I had my farewell talk to my staff in the Senate, I told them it could be any time. I mean, any day, the duration, we couldn't tell. It could be a few days, a few weeks, a few months, or even a few years, God forbid. And I never really thought that it would take that long before 7 years. Mm-hmm. I knew that the cases were all nonsense, were all fabricated, but it's just, you know, I didn't know how long would my ordeal take. Mm-hmm. So it was both really a feeling of disbelief and indignation. I could not believe that it was happening to me. I could not believe that my chief oppressor would go to that extent of jailing me. I thought it would just be daily vilification with all of his slut shaming hurled at me. Mm-hmm. But I didn't know that he would go to that extent of arresting me and letting me suffer in detention. Mm. So both disbelief and indignation. Of course, I was so indignant, I was enraged that suddenly I became also a victim of injustice. After years of fighting for victims of injustice and oppression, then I became a victim myself.
When during those times you weren't sure what to believe in anymore, when you didn't know a lot back then, when everything was happening, mm-hmm. what did you know for sure?
Well, what I was sure about is that I'm going to attain vindication sooner or later, that I knew that I would not really rot in jail forever, as what was really announced by my chief oppressor, because I still believed in the justice system, even if initially it had failed me. So I wasn't sure how long would my ordeal take, but I was also certain about the fact that someday the truth will be out there and I will be vindicated. My innocence will be proven and known to people.
Mm. Many times in the course of this conversation, you've said the phrase, your chief oppressor. Do you have a hard time saying his name? Do you have a hard time attributing to former President Rodrigo Duterte, number 16, all that you had to go through?
Not really. It's just that I would not really want to call him my chief oppressor, because I feel that everybody knows who the chief oppressor is. It's certainly the former president, Rodrigo Duterte, who really had so much vindictiveness in him. He launched this personal and political vendetta against me, using practically the entire machinery of the state and weaponizing the very law that he's supposed to uphold, both as a lawyer and as a president of this country. But he used it to weaponize his opponents, and I was one of them, the more prominent ones, and I was really the object of his personal attacks, vicious attacks, especially at my womanhood.
Madam Senator, are you angry? Is there a lot of anger within you still, and how do you deal with it?
Definitely I'm angry. But I have forgiven them, except for my chief oppressor. I've been saying that in all my interviews whenever I'm asked about that. Yes, I've forgiven everyone who had more or less participated in the persecution against me. But of course, I have not forgotten. And I cannot forgive at this moment the chief oppressor himself, Duterte.
Do you think that day will ever come?
Maybe. I'm actually praying for the grace to be able to do that. Because it's difficult for me. Mm. You know, he deprived me of my prime years, almost 7 years. Or 7 years. Mm. I mean, I lost a lot of opportunities. There were missed milestones in both my personal, family, and public lives.
Mm. Which we're going to talk about later on. But women, and you know this, San Leila, women most especially face many adversities. And to some, starting each day is a challenge. What can you tell them about how you were able to face each day? Because it was so much easier not to.
Yeah, well, I've actually adopted a very strict daily routine in my compound just to keep myself busy, because I wanted to fight off any feeling of negativism and depression. Although the anger is there, the disbelief is always there, but I told myself that I cannot allow myself or my spirit to be broken. That's why I have to endure and persevere, knowing that someday I would be vindicated. So strict daily routine, and I could sleep soundly, and you know, both physical, mental work, a lot of reading, a lot of praying, a lot of reflection, and also physical work, some exercises, and taking care of my adopted
cats.
Stray cats.
Yeah.
So that was, well, it helped a lot. I had to shy away from all those feelings of negativism.
Which is hard.
It was difficult, really, but it just had to be strong, and I am a strong woman, although I didn't realize that I had more capacity for courage, for strength, when I underwent that ordeal.
Which brings me to the next question. You mentioned it a while ago. You touched on the many losses and missed opportunities and missed milestones. But what have you gained despite the immeasurable losses that you've encountered?
I feel that I became stronger. That I feel that I became more open and more level-headed and more understanding of other people's travails and other people's shortcomings. I've become to be more patient. I was not that patient before, but really my faith has deepened because of my daily prayers and daily Bible reading. I've never been that close to the good Lord until I went through that experience.
You went into detention. You were a mom of two, and you were a grandmother as well of two. How did it change you? Because 7 years is a long time in kids, in the kids' world, right? You miss a lot.
Yeah.
Never mind our own personal things, but
yes,
to miss these things from the kids' life.
Yes.
and your grandkids. How did being in detention change you as a mom and as a grandmother?
There's the deeper realization how important family is. Because, you know, I was so busy then in my public life, and I always thought that my family would understand my busy life. Mm-hmm. So when I was in prison, I realized the family is so important. It's number one in your life, supposedly, next to God. Mm-hmm. So I actually became closer to my family, not only to my kids, but also to my siblings. Mm-hmm. And the more I missed my mom, who has not visited me then, because he's already bedridden for more than 4 years already. Mm-hmm. He is now semi-demented, although she never knew that I was in jail. Mm-hmm. So I valued so much now. I value now the worth of family and family life.
Mm-hmm. And when the world changed and when the world stopped, when the pandemic hit and you were inside, how did that make you feel? What were the thoughts?
Well, because, you know, for a few months there have been total lockdown. Not even family, not even lawyers, not even spiritual advisors could visit me. Mm. We could visit any of the detainees because of the total lockdown. So again, I tried to shove off the negative feelings. I tried to shove off loneliness, but I couldn't. You know, you cannot help being lonely. Mm. You're because you're all alone there. It's hardly that I see any other living being, except for the cats and the birds there who assemble in the morning in my compound. So the more I became homesick, the more I missed my family and I missed the world outside. Although some were telling me that you were more fortunate there during these difficult times of the pandemic, you're more fortunate because you're safer. Mm. Although I also got afflicted with I tested positive once, but without much symptoms, and I was cured easily. Mm. So I missed that. I got lonelier during those times.
And then when company came, and this was unwanted company, of course, when there was this attempted
hostage taking.
The hostage taking.
It was an actual hostage taking, not just an attempt.
Yeah. Was it? How surreal was that for you? That here you are, right? You're there, supposedly in detention, supposedly safe, and yet the unwanted visitor, the hostage taker.
Of course, it was so unbelievable. I didn't know it was. I felt it wasn't happening. It was so surreal. I thought it was just a dream or a nightmare, but when I realized that it was really true that it's happening. I felt so scared. I felt it was my end because the hostage taker was dead serious. He was thinking that he couldn't anymore go out of my quarters without being killed because all the snipers are outside, the SAF snipers. So he wanted to me to be with him in his last moments, and he wanted also to kill me. He said so several times that he would also kill me. So I got so scared. Although the way I was dealing with him, I pretended that I wasn't scared. So I was
talking
back and talking back at him. You know, like for example, he said he was asking for my cell phone, and I told him I don't have a cell phone here. Alam mo naman na bawal yan dito. Hindi po totoo yan. Meron po kayong cell phone. Hindi po ako naniniwala na wala kayong cell phone. No, it's true. I will kill you if you don't produce that cell phone. And I answered back, even if you kill me, you won't find any cell phone because I simply do not have one. Mm-mm. So moments like those, it was so. And I got really so scared when he started praying, because I couldn't understand because it was in Arabic, it was Islam, but there were the mention of Allah several times. So I thought, wow, he's now saying goodbye to Allah or asking for his forgiveness because he said so, that since his demands were not being met, it's about time that we go, that he will kill me first and then he will kill himself. So I got really so scared, and I also prayed quiet, silently, and sabi ko na lang sa Lord, bahala na po kayo sa pamilya ko. with just one request, that with another request that let it be quick. My death would be quick and not a slow death. So,
and when you mentioned family, Senator Leila, Brandon and Israel, they come to mind. Israel and Brandon, your eldest son and grandson, both with autism.
Yes.
How did they deal with not seeing you, not being with
well,
you?
Well, Israel, my eldest son, would regularly visit me, especially before the pandemic. Mm-hmm. Because the pandemic, there were restrictions already. But before the pandemic and when restrictions were relaxed, he would visit me. He would almost every week, every weekend, he would visit me. Now, Brandon, he visited me a few times only before the pandemic, and especially during the pandemic, and even after the pandemic, his parents, they thought that it would not be really safe to be bringing him there.
Yeah.
So.
How are you? How are you catching up on lost time now?
Yes, I'm trying to really catch up my lost time with them. Although, as I said, I'm also very busy now. Mm-hmm. So there are days that they would come to me. They would visit me in the residence of my brother, because I'm staying with my siblings. So, in fact, the other day, Vincent, my second son, the father of Brandon, they were there. The entire family were there for lunch. And Israel and I will be together this Holy Week. He's coming with me to Bicol, to Iriga City, to spend the Holy Week there. Mm. That's what I missed also, spending Holy Week in Iriga, because before my detention, every year, no miss, ever since I was a child, I would join the procession there every Good Friday, because our family has this, the Santo Nino, Santo Echero, image
that's been under your
family
care.
Yes, under the family's care for generations already. So and Israel would also join the procession, so we'll be together.
Now, you mentioned about, and we were talking about this before you went on air, but you mentioned your dear friends. You have Dinky Soliman, you have former CSC Chair Karina David,
yeah,
your former president Noynoy Aquino. You were in detention when they passed away. How is that like for you?
Those are one of the, you know, the saddest moments in my life. I could not even visit their wake. I cried. You know, kay Pinoy, kay Chair Karina, kay Sec Dinky, and of course some relatives, close relatives, and my sister-in-law, my only sister-in-law, the wife of my youngest brother, Vic Boy. So they left this earth while I was in detention, and I couldn't even visit them because the courts would not allow me. You know, I could not pay respects, my last respects to them. One of the saddest moments in my life, and one of the things that really made me angrier, that, you know, you deprived me of those times that I wanted to be with these colleagues, former colleagues of mine, in their last moments and during their wake. But, you know, my condition simply would not allow that, and it felt so bad. It's enraging, actually.
Do you think, Senator Leila, that you would have gone through everything that you've gone through had you not been a woman?
Well, major part of it is my womanhood, because Mr. Duterte really had this axe to grind against me. You know, he's been my target since I investigated him when I was with the CHR, the DDS killings. Mm. Our team in the CHR, the whole CHR actually, went to Davao City and held several public inquiries. And he was the very first witness or very first resource person to be invited. And I chastised him in public, in the very eyes, in full view of his official kingdom there. You know, the officialdom of Davao City. So he must felt really so bad about it, and he never forgot about it. And of course, it's because he's, he's averse and he's scared of strong women. To me, he's a coward. That's cowardice. You know, why hate strong women? And so it's part of it, really, because you all know the slut shaming that I experienced, the vilification, the demonization. the black propaganda against me and centering on my womanhood, labeling me as a woman of loose morals, an immoral woman, on top of the labels like drug trade queen or mother of drug lords, number one narco politician in the country. So all those offensive labels.
But here you are, now you're the spokesperson of the Liberal Party. Why are you allowing yourself to be put in that environment again, despite what has been taken away from you precisely because of this kind of environment?
It's not in my character, in my DNA, to just surrender, to just, you know, shy away from anything or from any controversy. I cannot just sit back while witnessing, while observing a lot of happenings in the political front. And it's my way of saying to my oppressors, to my persecutors, that you failed in your agenda of breaking me or breaking my spirit. So that's my way of showing it. Why should I? Why should I quit?
May I ask you about the opposition, Senator?
Sure.
What do you say, or what do you answer to the question, where is the opposition now? Has the opposition been blunted precisely because of your release, that it happened during this administration, and that sort of blunted the opposition in a way, sort of, it's a way of giving thanks to the freedom that you now enjoy, albeit temporary?
Not really, because you see, I was made an example before of anyone who would dare cross the then incumbent Duterte. So I was made an example, so everybody gets really so scared, and they would not have the courage to really frontally attack him those days. Now, yes, I cannot deny the fact that the break of the alliance between the Marcoses and the Dutertes have contributed to the fact that I'm now released, albeit only on jail. Because you see, the judges now would feel that there would not be pressure anymore on them, unlike the pressure exerted before by the former administration, especially Mr. Duterte, because he already convicted me in media. Insofar as he's concerned, I was guilty of the charges hurled against me. Now, because of this breakup of the alliance and with the Marcos administration exhibiting a hands-off attitude towards my cases, now the judges now feel that they're free to fulfill their mandate, that they could decide my cases based on the merits. Now, as to your point of opposition could have been blunted because of that, by way of
showing gratitude.
No, I don't think that is the attitude of the opposition. What the opposition, I'm particularly talking about LP, because, you know, we are not the kind of opposition would just be criticizing and then would be just for the sake of doing it and portraying our role as the opposition. No, we choose issues as to whether to be in favor or against the position of the administration. You know, in the WPS issue, the Chacha issue, the ICC issue, the Kibolo issue, We made our position there. And it's, you know, when it comes to the Cha-Cha, to the charter change issue, we are against the administration's move for that. And as you can see, Duterte is also supposedly or purportedly against it, portraying himself to be an opposition. To me, it's a fake opposition because it's all for self-interest and self-preservation. Now, of course, the issue on the ICC, we are for the investigation. We are in full support of the ICC investigation, and later the issuance of the warrant of arrest would be supporting that. So that would be against Duterte. The WPS issue, of course, the China's aggressive actions, and we are in favor of the current stance of the administration, going back to our traditional allies and pivoting away from China, unlike Duterte's posturing before. So it depends on the issues. Although we want, of course, to offer ourselves as an alternative. That is the very role of an opposition anyway, to offer itself as an alternative to the current, to the status quo.
And so we end the way we began, talking about your temporary freedom, Senator Leila. Is it only a question of when? Is victory within reach? Is it only a question of when this will be permanent? And if so, how do you intend to begin again?
I've been doing deep reflection on exactly the direction that I would be taking when I finally attain my permanent freedom. I'm going back to my private law practice. I want to resume, even if only on a limited basis. And I'm teaching now human rights law in Tanyada Jokno School of Law of De La Salle University. And as to politics, I'm still thinking about it. I'm not yet really mulling over what exactly are my political plans, but right now, no. I would not want to join the political fray for next year. Gusto ko munang magpahinga, but of course, pursuing still my core advocacy, especially human rights.
Former Senator Leila de Lima, one of the remarkable women we honor this month. Thanks for being strong. Really appreciate it.
Thank you so much. Quite a pleasure.